Hey, Richard, can you go ahead and just give me one good cough into the mic so I can filter that out later, too?
No, you know why? Because I mute mine!
Hello and welcome to the Ritual Misery Podcast, episode 108 for Thursday, the 29th of December, 2016. This is a show where two lifelong friends talk about geek stuff and whatever else comes to mind. I'm Amos, that's Kent, and Richard doesn't like me right now. How you doing, man?
I am doing well, and I always love being here. You took me by surprise. I wasn't ready for that cue.
You know, I mean, you provided the cue. I just hit the button. How you doing, Kent?
Oh my God, man! I am so happy to be here. It's Thursday night. It's Ritual Misery. It's time to party with Richard Gunther.
What? We're gonna party? Oh shit! I'm almost out of beer. I'm gonna have to milk this like you milk your beers. What?
I brought a whole bottle. I started at a dinner party tonight. I started on wine. I'm like, oh, I'll go back to the house and I'll grab a beer. I'm like, no, I started on wine. I should probably stick with wine.
You know, wine with an H or...
maybe a little bit.
There might be some of that tonight. You never know.
So this, we've decided that this week isn't going to be your normal episode. It's actually going to be us sharing our thoughts like good 70s kids do about 2016.
Yeah, the wonderful year that was.
The wonderful year that still is. Like we're not done yet. Every time somebody says, oh, well, I'm so glad 2016's over, somebody else fucking dies. Like, can we just stop that?
Wonderful. You keep saying that word. I do not think that means what you think
it means. Oh, yeah, exactly.
What is wonderful, though, is welcoming back Richard Gunther. We always love having him on. This is Richard. What is this? Probably like your fifth or sixth appearance on Ritual Misery?
Yeah, oh. Something like that. And there was a time when I was on the show when I was a big deal. Now you get actual big deals on your show. So I'm very glad to be back. Let me tell you.
Oh, Richard, you're the original Ritual Misery big deal. Let's just put it that way.
Definitely.
You're OG big deal on Ritual Misery.
Hashtag.
All right. So I figure we'll kick this off. Let's just get the elephant in the room talked about, and let's let the cat out of the bag and all the other euphemisms and cliches I can't think of right now. A lot of music people died this year. A lot of them.
Oh. God.
And it's probably no more than any other damn year, but it seems like a lot because they're starting to actually be important to us.
Yeah, major, major, major people in the music category. And every year we lose some stars and some personalities and some names that everybody cares about. But this year, it really cut deep for some reason.
And right out of the gate, too, starting with, I think Bowie was first.
Yeah.
Well, Bowie happened right after the new year. But then I think Lemmy happened right before 2015 ended. Right. So
you know what? It might have been January. It'd be great if we had a interconnected database of information.
Look,
only that kind of thing. And
you're asking too much of the show.
On New Year's Eve day last year, we lost Natalie Cole. So the whole thing just started like bad right from the start.
Yeah, but
yeah, it was actually the end of 2015 when we lost Lemmy Kilmister.
See, I thought so.
Yeah,
but yeah, it just right out the gate, David Bowie. Right there, it just kind of set the pace for the entire year because not David Bowie.
David Bowie?
David Bowie. I was confusing my early 80s sex idols.
Okay. All right. Did we switch roles?
I had George Michael and David Bowie mixed up in my brain for a second there as far as timeline goes. But yeah, that's kind of how it, Yeah. Towards the end of the year, we lost George Michael too, and maybe they were both. Maybe the inside circles of their families knew that they were coming, but I sure as hell didn't. Like, I had no idea, and I wasn't a huge Bowie fan. I loved a lot of stuff he did, but you know, the early stuff I wasn't so into. The late stuff I wasn't so into, but he was in Labyrinth, man. Like, one of my favorite movies of all fucking time.
And as bad as it was, it's awesome, right? I actually bought the Blu-ray anniversary restored edition of that. Holy crap, that's never looked so good, because I was always used to watching that on VHS. But
it never looked so good.
It is still as wonderful and as bad as it ever was.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
I just watched it probably a year and a half ago. Again, you know, probably like the 20th time I've seen it. And wow, was that early 80s ridiculousness horrible.
We can't talk about Labyrinth without talking about his junk. Because it was everywhere in that movie.
Oh, yeah. Yes. Definitely starring David Bowie's junk.
Like, he might have twirled the balls in his hand, but he was showing them everywhere.
Yes.
Holy crap. Yes.
Frank Oz and his puppets and David Bowie's junk.
Yes. Yep, exactly. No, nobody else in that movie is even worth mentioning, of course. You know, don't worry about it. Don't think about it too hard. Just accept it. It's puppets and junk.
I actually was a big Bowie fan. It was a huge Bowie fan in his kind of mid years, and because around the 70s, if I remember correctly, I think that was like the Major Tom time frame when that came out. That might have been the 70s 80s, I'm not entirely sure which. At late 80s, mid 80s, he kind of did this whole revival thing where he came out with China Girl and his Let's Dance album, and he had a follow-up album to that that was deeply soulful, and I love most of that album. I actually have both of those on vinyl. Mm. And how crazy is that? But this was huge to me, really huge to me, but not all. There was so much more that we lost this year. Shortly after that, Glenn Frey.
Yeah.
Now, most of people on my list of people that died way too young. We lost a lot of old people too. Absolutely, we lost old people. We lost an old person very recently, just yesterday as we're recording. We lost Debbie Reynolds.
Yep.
But we lost a lot of people who were way before their time. Glenn Frey from the Eagles, way before his time. Shortly after that, Prince. God damn.
All right,
I don't think anybody saw that coming.
Prince was, this is one of those unfortunate situations. I was actually home, and a good friend of mine, Jason Stewart, is a huge Prince fan, like huge. And I'm actually messaging him. I woke him up in the middle of the night to say, hey, because I was watching TMS, Scott Johnson and Brian Abbott. I was watching TMS, and the news was breaking as the show was finishing. And I was messaging him like, hey, man, I don't want to alarm you, but there's something going on at Prince's place. Like, there's somebody's passed away. Somebody's died. And it hasn't been confirmed yet. And he's waking up going, what the hell are you talking about? Don't crush my dreams. Like, why are you killing my soul? And that was a real hit. Like, I didn't expect that at all. Now, David Bowie, one thing. Prince, on the other hand, I'm a huge Prince fan. Man, that dude, he knew how to make some music. He knew how to send a message, and he lived in that persona, like his entire career life, you know, from the very get-go.
Seriously, I have like goosebumps right now while you're talking about this. I saw Prince in concert, probably one of the best live performances at a concert that I have ever heard. I usually hate when you go to a concert and the artist feels like they have to extemporaneously just like go on and on and on with the end of something or improvise or do whatever. I usually hate that shit. He was a master. He made you beg for more. And then I'd go to the album and I'd like, where is that? It's not there. I wanted to listen to that again.
Gint.
Just a total artist all the way around. I, you know, growing up, I always knew who Prince was, and he was always one of those ever-present artists. But I wouldn't have considered myself a huge Prince fan. Always appreciate his music, his performance, but always kind of from afar. So I'm not gonna lie like a lot of people do whenever someone passes away. I'm like, oh my God, it was such a soul-crushing thing, when they didn't really, you know, follow them all that closely. And Prince is one of those for me that, definitely appreciate him, but I can't sit here and I don't have the stories that you guys do.
Yeah, man, I heard that rip when you sat down. Look, there's certain things, certain messages of Prince's songs that he was like the maestro of innuendo. Like every song that he had, I mean, it was just completely laced with it. And I respect somebody that can send a message without saying the words. And even his music, just his music itself, would send a message of sexuality, whether it's sex or just personal identification or whatever. It was just great. And that was my first really big hit. Like, oh, fuck, what is going to happen now?
Yeah, you know, he was an amazing artist. I remember him, I think, out of high school and through college, and certainly into my post-college years. These were really not, I don't know that I'd call them groundbreaking, but his music pushed the bounds, and I totally appreciated that. I liked the way that he did it, and at the same time, he managed to make it incredibly popular. Well, other people who were trying to do similar sort of things were kind of pushed off. He managed to make it completely radio friendly, and it got tons of play, and people loved it. And I loved his stuff, and I think it's a huge loss. You know, there's two things strike me with Prince that I want to mention. One, if you haven't watched Purple Rain yet, which actually is a hard movie to get through because it's a very emotional movie, and it's tedious.
It tosses you.
It's a tedious tale.
It tosses you to and fro so many times in the same movie.
Yeah, it totally does. And it's a tedious tale of a difficult emotional story. And it's also probably one of the best closing concert scenes I've ever seen in a movie ever. The Purple Rain scene is fucking amazing.
Mm-hmm.
And the other thing is, like, there's an album, Sign of the Times, that to this day, anytime that I drive to my old school, I went to Penn State, and so for years and years and years afterward, I would drive up football weekends and stuff like that. And there's a place in the road, a particular intersection, where I know, okay, put in the album now, and this is the soundtrack for my drive for the next hour and a half. And I will probably always think of him that way, that this was a person who had a soundtrack of a part of my life. And not a lot of people really fall into the general populace's mind in that way.
The thing about Prince to me was, so I'm going to try to say this as sensibly as I can without offending too many people. I know, new for me. I'm not gay. I'm not. But there's something about Prince, and he was identified with a lot of gay culture. But even growing up, I understood that to be more of a sexuality culture, not necessarily a gay culture. And even recently, someone's mentioned to me how gay Prince was, and I'm like, no, he was just openly sexual. And there's something really powerful about that, when you can take society as a whole and have them accept your open sexuality, and especially in the 80s and early 90s, when a lot of that was just shunned and pushed aside, and he persevered through. And that alone endears me to Prince forever.
Okay, I'm gonna meet that, and I'm gonna best you. I am gay, and I don't get that at all. Like, I totally don't get why people thought Prince was gay. He had a feminine manner about him, but he was clearly into the women. There was like no question about that in his music, in his mannerisms, in everything that he did. It has nothing to do with his orientation. It was exactly what you said. It was that he wore sexuality out on his sleeve, and people are like, oh my God, he must be gay.
Yeah, right.
Yeah. Yeah. He wasn't the manly man. You know, he wasn't like, oh, I am blah, 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 blah. He, exactly like you guys said, he was very sexual, and he wore it and showed it to everyone, which is not a very masculine thing. It's more of a, you know, he had a higher pitched voice. He was very flamboyant at times, very showman like, and he didn't have that. Well, maybe he had some machismo, but not the like the overly like,
you know, right.
And I think that's really probably what it was, because obviously, I mean, he had women crawling all over him all the time, in like yep. every video he ever made.
And so, yeah, absolutely. Yeah, no, crazy. All right. No. Well, speaking of gay, we lost Dead or Alive's Pete Burns.
Oh, so this was one that I didn't know until it was in the show notes, until it was there. And I have commented previously and openly this video, and I'm going to bring it up here. This video is the gayest video I have ever seen in my entire life. Hopefully I'll be able to play without the sound here. This video is, it's just everything about it. And in the 80s, like, nobody wanted to admit it, at least in where I grew up in Palmdale, nobody wanted to talk about this kind of stuff. And this video, like, when somebody says, so explain stereotypical gay to me, and I'm like, it's like this video, just watch this video. This video, if you want to know what heterosexual super conservative America hates about gays, it's this video. This is what they're afraid of, that everybody's going to walk around like this. This is
and this is in the 80s, and by the way, totally hitting it. Like, right, he was, they had a huge hit their hands song.
And it's a good song. Like, I like the song.
Right. And everybody's like, oh, you know, they just blatantly ignore. It was like the Village People. No, they're just a bunch of friends, you know? Yeah. He's like, no, they're a bunch of cool guys. They happen to live in the Village.
Oh, yeah. It's the gayest video ever. Like, their Culture Club couldn't totally top this video. And, you know, it's...
Also, everybody ignored that. Come on.
But yeah, this is it's so clearly it's the complete effeminate, the flamboyant gay. Everything else is wrapped up in the video, and it's one of my favorites just because of the awkwardness of the video. And you can tell it was done on a like they could have filmed this with $50, including outfits. Like,
oh yeah, it's over the top, totally over the top. Okay, jumping around in time, but talking about gay. Dude, like in the last week or so, we lost George Michael. George Michael, I think the day after Christmas, we found out that George Michael died. Insane. In fucking sane.
This
was 53.
This is the 53. Opposite story. This was the opposite story to me, because this is when I thought of, like, when I was growing up and thought of gay, George Michael is what I thought of. And then it was like another decade and a half before he actually came out as gay. And when he did, everybody's like, oh my God, can you believe it? And I was like, yeah.
Yeah. No, thank you.
Duh.
It's like, of course he was gay. Like, he was definitely somebody that I was not surprised. And I don't even really know why. I can't.
Right.
There was no shock.
Maybe it was Wham. I don't know. But there's something about him that was just inherently like, okay, you knew. Yeah, he's gay. Okay, cool. Let's move on. He makes good music. Let's go with this. But
speaking of George Michael, a lot of stories have been coming out about him being a philanthropist, like an undercover philanthropist. And I haven't dug into this story that much, but where is this stuff coming from? Like, if it was all secret, where are the stories coming out now?
Yeah, I mean, it's not so much that it's a secret, but he has been behind and contributing to many, many philanthropic and human rights causes for years and years and years. And he's done it unlike how many Hollywood people do it, where they're like, I'm putting my name behind this. You know, I'm Brad Pitt, and I'm going to say that it's bad to be exploiting people to mine diamonds. Instead, he just put the money where his mouth was, and he contributed to a lot of funds and provided support to a lot of organizations that fought the causes he believed in deeply without making a big deal of it. And frankly, I have a lot more respect for that.
Yeah. Oh, you know. Definitely.
And yeah. I think this is one of those things where it's not a matter of the, like somebody outing him as this big philanthropist. I think it's just a matter of when you have a major star like that,
I see what you did there.
giving money and not wanting to be associated with it, kind of wanting to make sure that it maintains its own identity, and then they pass away, then you can well, it's not going to hurt their feelings anymore. Hey, you know, blah 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 blah. So it's kind of like this unwritten NDA, or it could be an actual NDA for all we fucking know.
Yeah. Yeah. So, all right. Well, there's more. We lost more. Emerson and Lake of Emerson, Lake and Palmer. Good God.
Yep. Yeah. This is when you start getting into the people that, okay, well, where do you draw the line of genuinely influential on my musical taste? Well, I can't say that ELP wasn't part of that, you know?
Richard, you recently told us that you were getting really into certain country music. Was any country stars that you follow or that you were enjoyed listening to this year? Was Merle Haggard?
Was Merle embarrassed me? That I didn't realize that Merle Haggard died this year.
My thing is,
I did not know this. I'm totally embarrassed.
Whenever you talk about these older country stars and like deep country, you know, like old school country, it always more surprises me that they were still alive. Like, oh, they're just now dying. Like, hasn't whiskey taken their liver like ages ago? You know? Like, when Johnny Cash died, he died. I was like, oh, that super sucks. I'm glad we got hurt out of it. Hey, how's he still alive? Like, how's he just now dying? You know?
Yeah. When Merle Haggard passed, it wasn't super surprising. He was an older guy. He'd been at this for decades and decades and decades. So that wasn't one of the shocker deaths of the year, but he was a major star.
That's a fair point. I think for me,
country music.
Yeah, no, you're right. I think for me, the thing was, I felt like a lot of people died before their time. You know, I don't remember which is which, and I apologize deeply to the people who care about this, but of Emerson and Lake, one of them actually killed themselves this year. And the other died of natural causes, and both of them died too young. Like, they are not of the Merle Haggard age. They are not of the age where you're like, oh, they're 90 something, they should be dead by now,
right?
And so it just felt like so many people, particularly in the music space and in the entertainment space, were taken way too young. And I can't get through my list without also listing the very recent death of nearly all of the Red Army Choir, which is the official choir of the Russian army. And, you know, say what you will about our relations with Russia, seriously, nearly all of the fucking Russian military army was killed in a plane crash a week ago. That fucking sucks.
Yeah, that's... I mean...
Yeah, that's just... Yeah, that's terrible.
It's always odd to me that you have a group of artists within a military function, whether that's the Russians or the was it the blue stripes and blue tops and blue. for the U.S. Air Force? It just always makes me feel, gives me like a weird feeling about it. But then anytime you have a large group of people that work so hard to accomplish things together and then they all die in the same accident, it's just tragic.
Yeah, whether it's a sports team or a choir in this or what have you. Yeah.
Moving away absolutely from moving away from
oh, Skype. We love you so much.
God, I hate Skype. Moving away from music, we had a lot of other people die this year that were totally unexpected. I'm gonna start with Alan Rickman because I didn't realize the body of work that Alan Rickman had until he passed away, and that made me very sad. I didn't realize, and this is my like bonehead move of the year, if I only have one. I didn't realize Alan Rickman played Hans Gruber.
Oh,
what?
Really? the classic Christmas movie, Die Hard.
Right. Like as soon as I saw it, I was like, oh, well, no shit. But until that moment, it just never quite clicked, and I was that made me sad.
I think it was the first movie that I ever saw him in, but the movie that really endeared him to me was Robin Hood, Prince of Thieves, where he was Sheriff of Nottingham, and I fell in love with that man's performances. He was brilliant in that role.
Yep.
Not to mention, he was the voice of Marvin the robot from the Hitchhiker's movie.
Yep.
Which I absolutely adore. He was great in that. He was, you know, Force Professor Snape in all of the Harry Potter movies.
Good bad guy.
Or the bad good guy, like.
Yeah.
right.
he was an angel. He was an archangel in what is it? The Jay and Silent Bob movie with the
damn it. Yes.
Yes, chat, help me out. I am drawing a blank on that one. But anyway, he's brilliant performance all the way across, and he is gonna be absolutely missed.
Dogma. Yeah, there you go.
Thank you, Wonder Mom.
Continuing on that same run, Miss Cleo died this year.
Yeah. Wait, is that like the like fortune teller?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And, okay.
And I just want to know, did she see it coming?
Oh, you're going to burn for that one, dude.
Somebody that didn't burn unexpectedly was John Glenn. And man, just being in the Air Force and having the history the Air Force has with space, stuff like that, that one was kind of a hit to me. Anybody that can leave orbit and go out there and do amazing things out in space, stuff like that, man, and just, you know, awesome.
I haven't made it a secret. My childhood dream was to be an astronaut. So growing up, like, every astronaut was a hero to me. Not only did we lose John Glenn, but we also lost Ed Mitchell, one of the Apollo 14 astronauts.
I forgot about that.
Yeah, I think he was the sixth man to walk on the moon, something like that. So two of my childhood real life heroes passed this year. And, you know, neither one of them were spring chickens. So, you know, they weren't like gone too soon kind of people, but I felt both of those passing just because they were, you know, I grew up idolizing this guy.
Yeah. And speaking of outer space, Ron Glass this year.
Oh, the Good Shepherd himself.
Yeah.
You know, and not only was he the shepherd, which was really the role of his that truly, you know, sticks with me in my heart, but he was also castmate with Abe Vigoda, who we also lost this year.
Finally and tragically.
Right. Yes. As the joke is, because hasn't he been dead for like 15 years?
He died in 82, 87, 91. I just read the article like the other day because I was telling my wife about it. Of course, Abe Vigoda is the face that I always recognize but never knew the name of, and the guy that famously made the Beastie Boys song One More Level of Deep for me. So,
right, yeah. But Barney Miller TV show from the late 70s, early 80s.
Right.
He and Ron Glass were both in. And I used to watch that show with my grandpa when I was little. And so, yeah.
I only ever knew him as Fish. Mm. That's like the only character that I knew him as.
Yeah. And he's one of those guys that's been in probably 200 movies. But yeah, I mean, other than Barney Miller, you know, I can't name another thing that he was in.
another tragic name, Gene Wilder.
Oh, God. Yeah.
Yeah.
That one hurt.
Yeah. That did too. And, you know, it's funny. I don't know why, except that it was one of these actors that I related to but that I revered significantly when I was younger, and because of the tragic, way too young loss of his wife, Gilda Radner, and others that he has starred with over the years. It was sad to see him go. He was old. I mean, he was one of the people where I felt like, okay, we lost him because he was old. But it's still sad.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Exactly.
Yep. The real Willy Wonka.
Yeah.
Yeah. Amongst many other like super amazing, hilarious roles that he played.
Another name that everyone knows, even if they don't know the name, is Alan Thicke.
That was one of my childhood dads.
Right.
Exactly. I think that's very, wow. I think that is very true. I think that a lot of people can't like look at these family sitcoms and these family dramas that they grew up with, and they relate to these as like, these are the role models that we had as dads. And whether it aligned with reality or not, a lot of people looked up to folks like Alan Thicke. What I think a lot of people don't know about Alan Thicke, and this is true about a number of stars in Hollywood, Alan Thicke was also a musician. And Alan Thicke wrote well over a dozen theme songs that we would know and recognize from 80s and 90s sitcoms and dramas.
Yep. He did Different Strokes. I think he did Silver Spoon.
They're kind of the same song, but yeah.
No, they're
one could argue that a lot of them are similar.
Yeah, like the early to mid 80s sitcoms that we all know and love, that he did most of those songs, or
right,
a good handful of them.
And I don't want to downplay any of these, but I want to kind of move it along to more happy manners. But some of the others we have on here. Anton Yelchin, way too young. Yeah,
the character who played the new Chekhov crazy accident. Young guy, very talented. What the fuck?
Yeah, and it was literally like the vehicle had a recall on it. It was just announced, and you know, it was perfect timing for bad events is what that came out to be. Muhammad Ali, like that's another one. I can accept it, but still, that's, man, what a legend to finally
Childhood pass away. Star. I mean, I remember watching him as a kid all the time.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Florence Henderson.
Oh yeah, a childhood mom. One of my moms growing up.
Sure. If you had a slutty mom, maybe. I don't know. I mean,
or if you just
turns
wanted.
Out there's a lot of good stories there.
If you just wanted a slutty mom.
Wow.
Finally, the twofer to end the year, Debbie Reynolds, and of course, the amazing Carrie Fisher, both passed away.
Yeah. Now,
back to back days.
If they're is any doubt about the possibility of dying over a heartache, over a loss, I don't know how you look at this and still think that. I have to imagine that this is one of those cases where the loss of her daughter was just more than she could bear. She and her daughter had a difficult relationship for much of their adult lives.
And stories.
But, Oh yeah, absolutely, absolutely. But I have to, I mean, there's no way, no way that this is a coincidence.
Yeah.
No fucking.
Yeah. So yeah. Carrie Fisher died the day after Christmas by heart attack. And then her mom, Debbie Reynolds, the following day by way of stroke. So both, just tragic.
Yep. I watched Singing in the Rain last night.
Oh, with Debbie Reynolds. Yeah.
Yep. Never saw that before. And I'm like, you know what? Good time to watch it. Actually, turns out, in addition to all of the like fluff in it, it's actually a really interesting story. It's about how actors deal with moving from silent movies to talkies. Like, I had no idea that that's what it was about.
Yeah, I didn't know either. That's one of those classic movies that I've never seen either. Yeah, not only did we lose Princess Leia, but a lot of people forget that we also lost R2-D2. Kenny Baker passed away earlier this year. And speaking of the rest of my nerd pantheon, as I'm calling it, that we lost this year, the actor who played Alf, whose name escapes me right now, we lost Alf and R2-D2.
Aww, yeah. I didn't know that.
Yep. That was one of the earlier ones in the year, I believe. Yeah. Way
wow.
Too many.
So
way too many.
So let's cap
and
off.
And Alf was all just on Mr. Robot.
What's that?
Alf was just on Mr. Robot this season.
Oh, really?
He was.
Oh,
he
man.
Was. It was probably old footage, but you know.
they're not shooting Alf anymore.
Yeah, I think a long time ago.
So PETA was like, so you want to have a fake animal that eats real animals?
Is that an art?
Yeah, let's cap off all that tragedy and move on to something far more exciting and more far reaching into the future. The 2016 election.
Woohoo! The loss of our democratic process. Oh, wait, I guess this is our revered democratic process at work, isn't it?
What a complete shit show the whole election was. And I'm this is one of those things where I'm glad I listened to Jury and his politics podcast, because otherwise I would not have known just how humorous and completely crazy the entire thing was. I would not have heard all the highlights. I would not have kept up as well as I did. And it was like the train wreck from the very beginning. It was the train wreck you couldn't let go of, and it followed through completely.
Yeah,
dude, it's been a shit show for 2 years now. This election has been going for basically 2 years, and it's been a shit show from go. The primary race, especially on the Republican side, the primary race, there was what, like 37 people or something like that, fantasy. So it was just it was crazy. And then of course, Donald Trump entered the race, which just added that reality show weirdness to it. And it just got weirder and weirder and weirder from then on. It's interesting that somebody that everyone just thought was a joke, and there's no way, like, okay, he's going to drop out at any minute. Oh, he's going to be pushed out of the race at any minute. Just kept going and kept going and winning and winning. And now he's our president elect.
Yeah.
I'm not sure how that
happened. Fuck yeah. Yeah. Good God. What the fuck happened? Seriously, what? Like, that's all I could think of on election night as I was getting drunker and drunker and drunker watching the results come in, is how the fuck did this happen? And I don't mean Republican versus Democrat. That is not what I am talking about.
Yep.
I am talking about, how does a country elect Donald fucking asshole Trump to be the representative of the purported leader of the free world? Oh my God. Are you kidding me? Are you fucking kidding me? I know not all of your listeners might agree with my opinions. I voted for Hillary. And I'm going to be honest about this. I voted for Hillary because I wanted Hillary. to be the president. I believed in what she was capable of doing. I believed in the history that she had and her understanding of how politics work and her ability to work with and or around those politics. Whether it be good or bad, I thought it would work. I don't think this will work. Yeah. I don't know how this is going to work.
Well, yeah, and you know, the interesting thing is, like, everybody that hated Secretary Clinton, it was very partisan. I mean, there are some people that are like, oh no, the Clintons, but most people have a deep hatred for the Clintons, and particularly Hillary Clinton, just because of partisan politics for the last 20 years. The Republican
and Party- And I want to be, I'm going to interrupt you here. Sorry.
Sure, no, go ahead.
And because she's a woman, I just want to state that there are a lot of people that are like, oh, no. This woman isn't going to tell me what to do. And right. You know what pisses me off? A lot of those people are women.
Yeah. Yep. That's true, too. But in the case of Hillary Clinton, though, the Republican Party and especially the right wing, talking heads, you know, like the Sean Hannitys and the, you know, people like that have been painting a picture of this evil monster that's Hillary Clinton for years. They've been setting this up because they knew that eventually a woman of this, what's the word I'm looking for? Setting high goals and going for them. I'm
right.
Drawing a complete
he has aspirations.
Aspirations. Someone that has such lofty goals, they know that eventually she's going to run for president, and they had to be ready for that. And so they've been painting this picture. So it really, that was part of it, I think, of why the nation was just like, okay, we can't have Hillary Clinton. Let's see what this other guy's got. I think that was a good chunk of the voting block was, you know, we can't have Clinton.
Yeah.
I fall somewhere in, I'm not even sure. I hated Clinton from the get-go. I thought she was just complete bullshit. The whole dynasty, the whole Clinton dynasty. I loved Bill. I don't trust Clinton. I know, and maybe it's just a matter of
right. I'm looking at Kent's reaction, and I'm agreeing with completely. Then what?
It does, because it was 16 years later.
Did you believe the propaganda? Everybody knew she was going to run for president. Everybody knew it. There was this was not a surprise.
Right.
This was not a surprise from the moment that they moved to New York. You knew why, and we knew what was going to happen.
Yep.
So what?
Yeah. I don't know. I mean, I understand some of it, but yeah, I don't know. Most of the stories about the Clintons, or most of the, the things like the backdoor dealings and all of that sort of stuff. Welcome to politics.
Right. That's how it works.
Highest level of politics. That's how it works. Period.
Right.
Tell me your favorite president or your favorite senator or whatever. I guarantee there's these stories and many more. So I don't know. That's just politics. That none of that really. I mean, there was a few things that have come up that bothered me. Private email server. That's some certain things would bother me. But again, you know, show me a politician that doesn't have a skeleton, or in the case of the Clintons, these aren't even skeletons. These are all front row.
They're out there.
Public things. Yeah. It's not things being discovered. It's things that we've known for years.
Right. The email server thing, I totally get. I totally get that. It's like, you can't get your job done if you use the tools you're given by the government to do your government job. Right. I totally get that. So in an effort to be more effective and be able to get stuff done, they set something up that was independent. You know what? Bad call. But as it happened, one might argue it allowed her to be more effective and get stuff done in a more timely manner than she otherwise would have been if she waited to get, do things by the book.
Well, here's one of the things I have about that, too, is that...
Oh, look, I wish our listeners could see Amos's face. I hope people are listening. If not, you need to come and you need to watch it roughly 47 minutes into the video, because his facial expressions while we're talking about this are priceless. He is literally clamping his lips shut. Maybe not literally, but he is holding them shut.
Well, the only point I wanted to make about the email server thing is this is not something she just did on her own. This is not a thing. The government at large allowed this to happen. It became a thing because of partisan politics. It was no politics. I don't give a shit who you are. You can't just do this. You could be a computer expert that works for the government. You can't just set up your own server and just have Nipper and Sipper and everything running into your house. That's not something that's even possible. It had to be allowed, and they allowed it. So, anyway, that's all I'm going to say about
this. All right, Amos, I'm going to say something. Don't take this the wrong way. Don't take this the wrong way, Amos. Open your lips, Amos.
Oh, do take it the wrong way.
I'm just going to say two things, I'm not going to try to justify anything. I thought the entire election was a complete shit show. If I had to choose any one of them, like if I didn't have the choice that I exercised in not voting, I would have chose Bernie Sanders, because that was the choice that I felt was most aligned with what I feel should have been carried forward, although that was still only like a 40% solution to me. The two points I'm going to make on Hillary Clinton, real quick. One, email servers. Her walking away.
It's your turn. I'll be quiet now while you're talking. I'm going to be quiet while you're talking. Talk now.
Her walking away from those email servers without any problems at all, no prosecution or anything, was a slap in my face as a military member who deals with classified information on a regular basis. And it was kind of the elite getting away with what the commoner couldn't. Fine. Willing to move past that. That's politics. Sure. But when she is on record in 93 saying she's against marriage equality and against gay rights and everything else, and then as time progresses, she slowly changes that opinion. But then when asked about it, she straight up says, I never had that opinion. We've got 20 years of you saying you were against it for all that time, and then suddenly one day you were unbiased, and the following news conference that you had that you were asked about it, you were suddenly for it. I don't mind you having progressive views, as in personally progressive. My views on life and on sexuality and everything else have progressed as I've gotten older, but don't sit there and fucking deny it when we have record of you saying something like that previously. Like, just acknowledge it. And if you can't acknowledge the simple thing that we have videotape of you telling Oprah about, don't fucking come at me with anything else. That's what lost her, in my opinion. Like, it was completely gone. Those two things, done. I can't do Clinton. Give me anybody else, and I'll do fine. Call me a double issue voter.
You just turned issues that I care about around on me. So I think that I think that the other candidate might have done that about every fucking topic.
Oh, you're talking about Trump.
Right.
Oh, well, see, that's just it. By the time it was Trump versus Clinton, I'd already given up on the corruption of the political system and given up on the election in total. So there's my views on all that. Now that we've gone through the political spectrum on the Ritual Misery podcast, let's find other misery to talk about.
No, we're not yet, because the misery continues, right? So let's look at where we are, all right? We are here at the end of 2016, looking at the start of the new administration with cabinet picks that look strategically as if they're intentionally designed to undermine the existing system. All right, maybe I'll give that to you. Maybe I'll say, if you're trying to make a statement that the government isn't working right, then your picks for your most trusted advisors and inner circle should be people who are going to disrupt. Okay, I'll get that to you. Maybe in all fairness. Now let's talk about the bullshit that is Trump continuing to bully citizens and representatives in Congress and people who are successful business people on Twitter. Like, here's a guy who has a pulpit. He's going to be the fucking president. And he's using Twitter to be a bully. What the fuck? Like, seriously, grow the fuck up. You're going to have your moment. Shut up and get, like, demonstrate that you can actually do some good. The election was over. And I'm like, all right, you know what? Maybe the government needs to be disrupted. Maybe we need someone to really shake things up. And you know what? I wish that if there were anything that I wish out of this administration, I wish that we could get to the point where we are in a position with government employees. And I'm sorry, guys, but I've been a contractor and you're a contractor now, Kent, so you understand this.
Actually, I'm a government employee. I'm not a contractor.
Okay, I apologize. You're a government civilian employee. Okay, I have been a contractor with government agencies for 20 years of my adult life. And I can't tell you how many people I've seen retire on the job. Both of you probably also have seen this yourselves more times than you can count. And I want somebody to be able to say, you're fired. And if anybody can do that, Trump knows how to do that. That's what he's good at.
Yeah.
Right? I want to see that happen. I want to see him disrupt how the government employment system works. I want to see it be merit-based, yep, not based on how long you've been there or how many steps you've taken or whatever the bullshit is. It needs to be based on reality. And I thought that could be a good thing. What did he do? No, he didn't do that at all. He started picking fights. He started picking people who were going to not just disrupt, but revert. In many cases, pull us back from what many, many people, bipartisan, would agree are better approaches and better policies and pull us away from them. And I don't understand that. And finally, I have to say something about how his refusal to speak out or take any real active voice against the hate that is spewing, not just on social media, but in real life. Real life people are getting bullied. Real life people are getting attacked. And it's getting justified by him being in position. And part of that is just the white supremacist following that he has. And part of that is the shit that he spews out, and the people feel that it's fair for them to adopt and follow as well. And we can't survive as a country if all we're going to do is tear each other down. That cannot work. Can you imagine? Like, can you imagine any other candidate doing nothing but spewing nasty shit for the months that preceded going into the office? I can't imagine that. And in fact, what is ironic about this is that, you know what Hillary is doing? Hillary is highlighting the good things that are going on in our society right now. She is identifying the things that we can rally around, while Trump continues to isolate and segregate and anger the social groups. I don't have a tolerance for it, and I am truly frightened for our future. And I don't mean that as rhetoric. This is not me saying, oh, yeah, I'm going to move to Canada. I am particularly today, the day we're recording, we know now about sanctions against Russia, that Ryan, who I had such I wanted Ryan to take such a stronger stand than he has. And he had the opportunity to do that. And he's a smart guy, and I'm so frustrated. But we've now put sanctions against Russia, and this is what we go into the next administration with. I am scared. I am truly scared for the future of this country.
Yeah,
I'm done. I'm stepping down for now. Okay.
I want to echo some of the points that you made. A lot of the division, the social division that's happening, we can say that it was already there, but it's definitely being highlighted over the last year, especially in the last several months, leading up to the election and following the election. The divisiveness between ethnic groups, the strong anti stances to anything equal rights, whether we're talking race, sexuality,
religion.
Well, they
seriously, religion is a big one right now.
But yeah, you're absolutely right. The call to ban Muslims, things like that. I don't know. I mean, there's always been this sect of our society that wants to, lump people together and blame them. Like ever since 9/11, there's been an anti-Muslim undercurrent in our country. But it's always kind of been like on the side, on the fringes or whatever. But now you're absolutely right. It's very in your face now. People aren't afraid to say certain things anymore. People, I would say it's definitely in the minority, but a lot of people aren't afraid anymore to act out that might have been a year ago, 2 years ago. Act out meaning like physically attack people because of their religion or their race or sexuality or what have you. And that's incredibly worrying to me. Whatever politics anybody believes in, whatever party you align yourself with, whatever, that's one thing. But people are people, and we're Americans, and we're in the 21st century. I mean, come on, people. We have made such progress, not just in this country, but in the world even, with advancing, understanding that we're all, I hate to bring back like the Constitution or whatever, but we're all created equal. Like we're all created equal. And we're getting to the point in our society where we're actually starting to act like that. These have been words for a long time, but we're actually starting to act like that. But now in the last several months, we're visibly regressing from probably the first time in our nation's history we've actually regressed when it's come to equal rights, treating people with dignity and respect. And that bothers me.
Every asshole has their day. This is just one version of that, and I think we'll be fine. we're gonna be fine
in the long run. Yeah, like if we look 100 years in the future, this passed. I know this is going to pass. That's not
if we look 5 years in the future, we'll be fine.
Really?
The world's not
5 years.
The world is not going to go to shit because some jackass rich white guy with too many fucking too many dollars and not enough brains made it into the White House.
George Bush.
So right, and we're fine. We're fucking fine.
Yeah, it took 8 years to recover. We're still phenomenally in debt. Okay, 16 years ago. 16 years ago, we had an economic, we had a surplus, right? Now we're still significantly in debt.
We've been in debt since, I don't know, the late 1800s or some shit, we haven't had a balanced budget, but like twice in the last 150 years. Like none of this matters. We're going to be fine. We're going to be fine. It's going to be fine. It's everything's going to work out just like all the smart home stuff in your house, man. It's all going to be fine.
Oh my God, speak about a transition. What I really want to know is what about Russia? What about Russia, man? What do you think about Russia?
They don't have smart home stuff there. They barely have electricity. So,
oh, well said.
So I bought into the smart home this year, and I got to tell you, it's been fun. It's been expensive, and it's been exciting. Richard, you are way more into it than I will ever be. What's been your most impressive moment of this year for smart home stuff?
This is a kicking and dragging transition. So, so we are obviously moving from the things that frustrated us to the things that interested us this year. And obviously for me, tech in the smart home, there were a lot of highlights. I think there were some interesting things to talk about. And for me, I think there are two things that are the biggest to note. One is that voice assistants, and in particular, I'm talking about Echo. I think the Echo from Amazon was a huge unexpected hit. I don't think anybody expected that to be as big as it was. And, you know, we say as big as it was. 300 million households. We think they sold 5 million of them. All right. Maybe 1.5 million people. Maybe 1.5% of the households in America have one of these things. It's probably less than that because people who buy them are buying a few of them. Right. And you have yours off just in case I happen to say her name. So I think that is a big and interesting change this year, and we're going to see more of that next year. The other thing that I think was really interesting is that, you know, for years, 2+ years now, I and many other people who follow smart home tech were wondering, this HomeKit thing that Apple's talking about, is it real? Is anything going to become of it? Are people going to care? And now it's just there. You just buy shit and it works. I mean, how fucking cool is that? You buy something in the Apple store or you buy something at Best Buy that has the Apple HomeKit logo on it and you install it and it freaking works on your iPhone. You don't even have to download the app that comes with the vendor. All you have to do is use the built-in software on your phone. And it works. And if you can get Siri to understand you, then
so it does in fact work as advertised.
It does. And Siri can actually control it. And here's the thing, it took like 2 years to get there. Like, I tested every device that was available last year with Siri, every single one of them. And maybe 50% of them worked 50% of the time. It was a disaster. It was an absolute disaster. This year, the devices that came out, every single one of them that I tested, and I did not test all of them, but every single device that I did test this year that is Siri compatible worked as it was supposed to, worked as advertised. I was very impressed. Awesome. You sounded like you were going to say something. Is there a different experience in your household?
The thing that gets me, the most frustrating thing for me for this whole smart home thing, okay, so HomeKit, like, yeah, the stuff works. Some of the options aren't necessarily there, but it works. It just magically, like, works. The most frustrating thing for me with smart home stuff this year has been getting my family to stop talking special to Alexa. Just stop.
What does
just,
that mean?
Just sure. Talk normal.
What does it mean?
Because they yell at it or they say the keyword and then they pause for like 10 seconds waiting for it to react. Like, no, just go. Just talk. It's just like a normal
Turn
person.
Turn on the living room lights. Yeah.
it's like
okay.
Like, if you were talking to another person like this, it'd be like, Jimmy, go outside. And it's like, that's not it. And then they're like, it doesn't work. Well, no, because you're talking like a person with special needs. Like,
that's a people problem. That's not a problem.
Right. The tech is fine. The people are fucked. Like,
okay, George Carlin.
Why the robots are going to win.
Yeah, exactly. Because they can talk to us. We can't talk to them. I don't. Yeah, but yeah, I've got my Ecobee and it works fine. I've got two Amazon Echoes. I got the Dot and the regular Echo upstairs. And it's exactly as advertised. I've got two C by GE lights up in the bedroom upstairs to help set the nighttime mood and the morning mood and, right, and all this stuff. And they're super basic. They're super cheap. They don't do anything other than what's exactly on the box, and it works perfect. And I think that's what it is. If you don't expect it to do more than what's actually written on the box, you're fine. And I think it's an amazing place that we've actually gotten there, where you're looking at the box and you're going, it's going to be awesome. You get it home and the shit just don't work. We're not there anymore. We're at the place where what it says in the box is what actually happens, and it's glorious.
That's super encouraging to me, because I love the idea of a smart home. I want the Jetsons house. Like, I want that.
Well, so that's the thing, though. I need to caution you, as you're all excited about this, I need to caution you, because the smart home that we have today is not the Jetsons house.
So understood. But I think that this year we made some serious strides in overcoming some of the things that bothered me, some of the barriers of entry for me.
Yeah, we did. But Rosie is still not going to iron your underwear for you. Sorry.
Not yet. Some of the things that have been addressed this year that were barriers of entry for me was the competing standards. There's like no standard of like, okay, so I want to buy this product and this product and this product because these are the exact things that I want, but they don't work together. But with the success of HomeKit, as an example, where more and more products are compatible with a common set of standards, that's very encouraging to me. And I expect in the next few years it's going to get even more and more and more compatible.
So there's like two things that I want to point out about that. One is that HomeKit is interesting because you could argue that HomeKit is a standard in and of itself, and it is with a small s. But it's big enough because it's Apple that enough vendors are willing to say, oh, well, we need to do this. If we need to be relevant, we need to do this. So whatever else we're doing, we need to be HomeKit compatible. And so that makes it more, I would say, accessible and usable by more consumers. The other thing is that the Echo essentially basically blew up the standards issue. Because the Echo said, we don't care what standard you use. If you have an API, we are going to allow you to be controlled by your users, by voice, with a common interface, common language. Everybody can control you with the same language, regardless of whether you're IP-based or Wi-Fi-based or Bluetooth-based or Zigbee-based. As long as you have an API that we can talk to, then we're going to bridge that gap. And I think nobody saw that coming.
I think the big thing on that was when they started integrating IFT. Once IFT was fully integrated within the Amazon ecosphere, that really opened up everything, because if you have any kind of integrations or interactions at all, suddenly you're open to everything. And that's been amazing.
So, here's the quote I'm going to regret in my professional life. You ready? Mark this time. All right. We're roughly at about 1 minute, 1 hour and 10 minutes in. I fucking hate IFT.
Oh, man. And career death on Richard. Boom. And
all right. Well, okay. So my concern, I already said that this is encouraging, that the standards are becoming more adopted, more, and then you said yourself that everything is becoming more accessible through more things, right? So this is encouraging to me as being removed as a barrier of entry, but also it's kind of a scary thing, because if anything can control anything, that opens the door to security problems.
We only had one major botnet powered by devices this year.
See, that's not true. That's the one that got the press. I mean, there was a lot of security hacking that wasn't, it didn't get the press attention. It wasn't interesting enough.
Because it didn't take out half the Eastern Seaboard.
Here's the one that did. You know what? The one that did? The one that did get the attention was the headline that had DVR in it. Oh, you're hacking DVRs. No. Our DVR- nobody's hacking your fucking TiVo. Calm the fuck down, all right? What's happening is that people who have spent a lot of money on a Chinese manufactured set of cameras that has a recorder that records a frame every second or every minute or whatever it is, those devices were not properly secured. They were not properly secured by the manufacturer, and they were not properly secured by the installer. So calm down.
I'm sitting there thinking,
it's not getting hacked.
Who the hell's going to hack a TiVo? You can't get that shit to work when it's not hacked. Like, oh!
I think there's only like 12 people that still use a TiVo.
Oh, no.
Hey, I'm one.
Oh, my God.
Okay, so you 11 others.
I've never been happy with the TiVo experience, even though for a long time it was the best experience you could get. It doesn't make you good. Okay, so speaking of trickery, Windows 10 tricked Microsoft kind of tricked a lot of people into upgrading to Windows 10 unnecessarily. And I know everybody in the nerdosphere has decided that was just a bad deal and a raw deal and everything else. I didn't have a problem with it personally because I upgraded early, I upgraded often, and I enjoyed the upgrade. Even from 7, I think 10 is a better operating system.
Hmm.
So I would agree that Windows OS was Windows Vista, so I can't speak to this.
Oh, wait. At home or at work?
At home. I don't even pay attention to what's on my nipper computer.
So you have not upgraded from Windows Vista at home?
No. Well, I don't upgrade from Mac OS to Windows 10.
Oh, okay. I get it. I understand. All right. So I, too, have largely moved to Mac OS, but I still have Windows stuff going on, and I talk about Windows and I report on Windows, and I have a podcast where we talk about Windows entertainment technology, and a lot of that is based on Windows 10. And you know what? I kind of feel like Windows 10 is a lot of good and a lot of bad. Like, I feel like they did a lot of things right. They fixed a lot of the stuff that they got wrong in earlier versions of Windows, Windows 8 and Windows 8.1. I also feel like Windows 10 was a backpedaling to doing what they knew was right and focusing on the things that were important in the operating system. And so Windows 10 really focused on desktop. Windows 8 did not. Windows 8 had this delusion, this, you know, we talk about how Apple and Steve Jobs in particular, when he was alive, would create this field and this drug that he would put people under, where they would just buy anything that they talked about. It was the Apple, I forget what they call it, but the reality distortion field is what they call it.
right.
And I felt like somewhere, Steven Sinofsky has naked pictures of someone in Microsoft that allowed him to cast his own field across the organization and convince the whole company that they should say, no. This desktop thing, that's ridiculous. Everything's going to be touching the next 3 years. Bull fucking shit. That's reality. How did you ever believe that?
Windows 8 went the same way that the original tablets went. Man, that's an interesting idea. Everybody should try it. Oh, wait. No one likes it.
Does it work?
No one likes it. It's not functional at the basic level we need it to be functional.
And here's the thing that was ironic about that. Windows 8 was fucking awesome on tablets. Tablets, only tablets, nothing else. Not your desktop, not your laptop, not your phone. It made no sense anywhere but on a tablet touch environment. And you know what? Nobody wants to run Photoshop, all of its menus and modal dialogues and all of that shit on a tablet. That is not what you use your tablet for. You use your tablet for light duty access to content and light duty access to manage and potentially edit stuff, but you are not doing heavy duty desktop activities on your laptop. And how they thought they would be one and the same, which Microsoft has for some reason believed for the last 10 years with their first generation tablets that failed, I don't understand. So yeah, that failed. Now Windows 10 is out. It's a backtrack. It realizes that, you know what, desktop, it's good. It's good. We like desktop. We love desktop. We want you on our desktop. We want you on our Windows. So much so that they put Windows 10 on every fucking thing. Xbox. My Xbox runs Windows 10. You know what? That sucks.
Wow. So, Windows 10. three quarter desktop. Thumb?
Up. I'm up. I'm up for the desktop. I like it. The desktop. But
Amos, have you had any experience so far with virtual reality?
Yeah.
Firsthand. 2016.
I tried the Samsung Gear VR. I thought it was pretty awesome. I can neither confirm nor deny that there's lots of porn out there that's in 3D. It's really confusing if you don't have 3D rig.
Wait, I think I remember an episode about this.
Oh my god.
So I might have heard.
See porn again?
So I might have heard.
That's interesting. I'm gonna have to take that out just to have that
Please, we don't be a link in the show notes.
So I tried the current gen VR for the first time within the last week.
Mm-hmm.
Stephanie upgraded her cell phone to the new Samsung. Well, the newest Samsung. What is it? The 7.
Not the Galaxy 7. Not the Note 7, right?
No. I think
definitely not that.
I think it's a plane. S7. Anyway, so Verizon was doing a promo deal where you got a free Gear VR headset. Mm-hmm. If you have it was the Galaxy S7. So, like, okay, that's a cool surprise. So she tried it out, and I got to say, like, now, Gear VR is not the end-all, be-all VR experience that everyone is talking about, like with the Oculus Rift or the
Vive.
What's the other? The Vive, the HTC Vive. But powered by a cell phone, this is pretty badass, and the hype is real. Like the current gen of VR, it's real, man, and the potential is every bit as high as what everybody's been saying.
And how ironic is that? Like that it's through your phone, not through these extra computers. It's through your friggin' phone.
Right. And that's my point. Exactly. This is like the lowest level of VR that you can find right now. And it's so incredible and immersive. I cannot wait to get my hands on a Vive or, you know, a full blown Oculus Rift, because the Gear VR is made by Oculus.
Right.
They're the ones that put that out in conjunction with Samsung. But the full up Oculus Rift, like, I can't even imagine how immersive that would be.
That's so awesome.
I absolutely believe, like, the Jeff Canadas and the Brian Brushwoods and everybody that's hyping this thing up. I believe it's every bit as amazing as they say it is, and it's only going to get better in the years to come. this is entry level shit, and it is already blowing my fucking mind. And I cannot wait.
I'm getting reports that there is a certain event that's happened recently where you might have taken advantage of the limited scope of someone else's VR visage, and you might have taken that and So what I'm hearing is that you decided to scare the shit out of somebody by touching them.
So Stephanie, when she was trying this out, one of the first things that she tried was a horror movie, like a first person perspective horror movie, you know, and I guess it was from the point of view of the main character, and she could look around.
Why would you start with that?
Why wouldn't you?
Because she was so anti horror. She was the one that was like, no, I'm not going to do these horror experiences. And what's the first thing she fucking does is loads up this horror app. So of course, 20-30 minutes into this thing, because she was into it, 20-30 minutes into it, she's like walking around the kitchen all like, oh. So of course I was like, okay, I'm not getting any attention. I want to see what happens. I put my finger on her shoulder and she, it was pretty great.
So you took a 3D virtual reality experience, threw it into 4D, and then 4D all because 12-year-old Kent wasn't getting attention.
She says in the chat in all caps right now, I trusted him.
Right. That's like the kind of thing that in movies, in sci-fi movies, they're like, no, you can't do that because it'll completely like destroy his mind. He won't understand what happened to him while he was in that space.
Yeah, this is like full on Black Mirror stuff.
Yeah. Oh man.
Yeah. Richard, have you tried any of the VR stuff that's come out this year?
So I haven't tried any of the new stuff. I had an opportunity to try one of the first generation Oculus Rifts. And part of the problem for me is that I don't see 3D. So I have a hard time with anything that tries to recreate an experience in real life based on 3D imagery. Because basically what I end up seeing is double or one thing very blurred and one thing not so blurred.
Gotcha. It sucks.
Yeah, it kind of does. But the Oculus first gen did a really good job of somehow, and I don't know how, I don't understand the technology, basically working around that. And
I want to interrupt you real quick. Did you experience this with or without your corrective lenses?
I experienced it with my lenses, but my lenses don't correct my 3D failure. They only correct my nearsightedness. Yeah. Oh,
got it. Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah.
So as far as depth perception, my lenses don't really help with that. But the Oculus first gen did an amazing job of convincing me that I was in the space that I was. And I don't know if you ever experienced first gen Oculus. It was very pixelated. It was very artificial. There was no trying to trick your brain into thinking that this was reality. And yet, I perceived it in a space with depth, which blew my mind. I didn't expect that at all. And so I am actually hoping that at CES coming up, I get an opportunity to try some of the newer things, because the stuff that's out there now, just it's unbelievable. And really what I want to try more than anything, what I think is probably more interesting than most of the VR stuff out there is, and I have to say this, what Microsoft is doing, and yes, it's based on Windows 10 with air quotes, HoloLens. I think the HoloLens stuff is really fucking cool. This augmented reality, let's wake up, folks. This is not holograms. Holograms are a completely different thing than what Microsoft is talking about. But what they are doing is really fucking cool. They are creating a layer on top of your reality that allows you to experience things in new ways. And all I've heard about it is good. And I'm really looking forward to trying it. There's a store in New York, not too far from here. I haven't had an occasion to get up to New York yet, that allows you to reserve time and check it out. And I'm hoping to do that in the next couple of months.
I'm hoping something like this is readily available while we're at South By. I know that's typically not a place to show off big things like this. It's more of a CES kind of thing, but I'm really hoping.
I think that's slightly.
Well, no. Yeah, well, yeah. 2 years. I think it's slightly. 2 years ago, Amos, if you remember, we went to that gaming expo. Mm. They had the Oculus Rift, and I don't remember if it was Vive. There was another one,
right?
That was very much on display at South By. It was just that the line was 7 miles long.
It was the problem. It was literally a 3-hour line, and we had about 3 hours to enjoy the entire expo before we had to leave.
Right. Exactly. I think that's a good point. I think there is a very good possibility we're going to see more of that at South by Southwest. Certainly, Samsung is a big player at South by Southwest. They rent out a physical location right across the street from the convention center every year, an entire building where they promote a lot of the stuff that they're working on. And since they're no longer trying to sell music through the stupid service called Milk, maybe they can use that space with instead more VR headsets, and you'll get a chance to try it out. I know last year they were giving away the Oculus adapter for your Galaxy as a part of a promotional kit where you bought your Galaxy there and you got this crazy deal, including this free headset. And my friend Kathy, that you know and that came with me, that we go with every year, she ended up getting one. So I think it's totally possible that you'll get a chance to try it out this year.
That'd be awesome. Hey, speaking of things a little bit in the future, this has been a kind of a big year for the three of us individually. I know personally the success of Ritual Misery and the moving around that we've done and going from Korea back to Texas up to Alaska and the things I've experienced up here have been amazing. And it's really just added, my life story has several chapters that start in this last calendar year. And it's been really, really awesome. Richard, what is, if you were to highlight just specific things about your year, 2016, for your personal life, you know, what would that list start with?
Well, I think the biggest thing in my year is that I think Ritual Misery came out of beta this year.
In Richard's life.
Right? I mean, that's a big deal.
That was a huge deal for it. You know, a lot of people talk about how, you know, 2016 was such a shitty year. Well, in certain ways it was. But for Ritual Misery, 2016 was a huge year. It was a great year for us. We started out the year basically with, we started the year with Tay Allen right out of the gate. And then shortly after that was South by Southwest making our second appearance. We did a successful Diamond Club meetup there.
It was so much fun.
Of course, the Countdown to 100 campaign that ultimately resulted in us leaving beta officially.
Yeah, so I want to take a minute and just pause and give you your due attention there, because, you know, you're glossing over that like, oh, yeah, Countdown to 100. Yeah. Okay, what happened in Countdown to 100? All right, so we started the year, and you mentioned Tay. All right, so I think, if I remember correctly, was the next episode after Tay. So that there's no pressure there at all, right? None at all. Well, Richard's going to come on. Tay just like blew everyone away.
On that note, though, Richard, last year, you're absolutely correct, and I was going to bring this up. So last year we had Tay Allen on, was the first guest of 2016, and the second guest was Richard Gunther. So you complained about having to follow up Tay Allen. Well, now you are returning the favor because you're the first guest of 2016, and Tay is going to be the first guest of 2017. So now she has to follow you up.
right. Well, that's fair. That's fair. I appreciate that. I totally appreciate that. And I adore her. And I think that she's a lot of fun. So I think your guests are in for a treat. But here, like, the thing is that at the beginning of the year, Kent, you and I were talking. Just, I don't even think Amos was in the conversation. I think, I don't know what happened to him. He was like off. He had to like deal with life or something. You and I were talking, and I'm like, all right, here's the thing. And I'm thinking, you know, I know you guys are doing well, and you guys just joined Diamond Club, and you're doing some really cool stuff. And we wanted to talk about things that would, you know, we could edge each other on a little bit. We could try and get each other to play our A game. I'm like, all right, well, here's the thing. Get Veronica on. Get Veronica Belmont on your show.
Yeah.
And you're like, all right, game on. That was unfair. That was really unfair because I mean, it's not like Veronica's a friend or anything, but I kind of know Veronica Belmont. And so I had her on my show. And you guys are like, okay, yeah, whatever, that's great. We're gonna have Brian Brushwood and Tom Merritt and oh yeah, Jury and oh let's see, who else? Everyone else from DTNS, like let's see,
Patrick Beja,
Scott Johnson,
Allison Sheridan.
Yeah, I mentioned Allison. Okay. So yeah. So I think you showed me up a little bit.
So you're saying we should call it a draw?
We still have not yet had.
Oh wait, Veronica, I won't. No, that's right.
Yeah. That was yes. I wouldn't call it a bet. It was more of an inter show challenge to get Veronica to guest on the show.
This wasn't a bet, although you know someone owes me a beer. But I think that what happened was that we all tried to play our A game this year, and that is a good thing, right? So I got people on that I think people who are interested in tech and smart home wanted to hear about it. And you got people on who are interested in what's going on in the geeky space in general and what's going on at Diamond Club wanted to hear about. You got like the best guest you possibly could have guessed, could have had on the show. And you blew me away. I am so impressed by what y'all pulled off for your run to 100 and frankly, your run out of beta. And that's the thing that's most important, right? So no more technical errors, Amos.
Errors. And no progression is without error.
Yeah, but no. And I appreciate your words, Richard. That means a lot to us because you were one of our early mentors. You were the first real podcaster that gave us any sort of advice and encouragement. And
now I'm on the A-list.
No, we love you, Richard. You will always.
That's a Kathy Griffith of podcasters now.
Oh my God! But no, say we had this like basically an all-star lineup leading up to our 100th episode, which you were a part of, Richard. I think you were on episode 94 or something like that.
Yep.
But the thing is that we didn't stop there. We kept going. You know that it was after 100 that we got Patrick Beja and Allison Sheridan and so forth. And so I wanted to lead into our lineup for the next few weeks. I already mentioned that Tay Allen is our next guest. After that, we've got Jason Murphy. You might know him as Captain Murphy, co-host of The Modern Rogue with Brian Brushwood. He's also a noted author. All kinds of cool stuff that he's got going on. Also, the week after that, we've got Christy Cates coming on.
Yeah.
Diamond Club's own Christy Cates, the musical sensation herself. So we've got, you know, we haven't stopped. We are continuing to try to get the best guests that we can get. And we've been pretty successful so far. And I hope that continues into 2017.
Kent, you mentioned Christy Cates, and I just want to say that right now I happen to have an inside line that she's currently bailing me out on making some graphics for our 2017 Streamathon.
I did.
Like, she's pretty awesome, and just conversations that I've had with her are pretty great. But that does bring me to the 2017 Streamathon. We are going to be casting 27 hours straight, brand new content. What do we have, 19 or 20 people that are going to be streaming different shows and different things? Some brand new streamers, some legends of Diamond Club, and it's going to be pretty awesome. We've got a lot of effort going into it, and this is all an effort to keep New Year's a celebration that no one has to have alone, and to raise some money for some sick kids while we're at it.
Definitely, man. We've got such an all-star lineup. It is absolutely incredible. We're going to kick the whole thing off in just over 24 hours, dude. It's less than 36 hours away to the kickoff to this thing. Can you believe that?
It might frighten me just a little bit, to be honest with you.
I realized just just a few hours ago that we were within 48 hours, within 36 even. I was like, oh my God, holy crap. So I started to freak out a little bit. But I think we're basically ready to go. Like I said, we're going to kick it off, me and you. Mm-hmm. We're going to move into Bonnie Brushwood, the Invisible Wife herself. She's going to do a morning workout for everybody. It's going to be amazing. I can't wait for that. We've got so many people, man. We've got Captain Fubar. We've got Hot Beverages. We've got The Gin from the Geek Grills podcast. We've got Roberto Villegas, Crunchy, Stacy Reese, Jackie Hearn, Scotty Emo,
John
Richard Gunther. Oh, no, wait, I'm being lame. No, never mind. I'm not on that list.
We might still have people. We might have openings.
And John Teasdale is going to... he is going to play the contender with the audience, and we are going to elect our very first, unofficially now, but our very first president of Diamond Club.
Seriously, how does that work?
We all play the game with the co-creator, and whoever wins gets the title of unofficial president of Diamond Club for at least the next year.
That's crazy.
If you're gonna have debates that mean something, if you're gonna have a political system that is rooted in honesty and everything's out on the table and streamed live and there's no second guessing, come be part of that and help vote for the first Diamond Club president.
Yeah, but you know, it's going to be awesome. The aforementioned Christy Cates, I mean, there's so much. The Hat Man himself, Brian Ibbett, Coverville.
Yep.
Got an hour, like so much.
That actually makes me feel awful, because right now we have Brian Ibbett as one of our streamers, but we've never actually had him on the show. So
we will change that in 2017.
Let's try to fix that, because he's an amazing dude. He's got some, if you're into music, he has some of the most ridiculous projects going on. He's got one, man, I wish I could remember the name of it off the top of my head. He's got a project where he and another musical friend of his listened to an entire catalog of an artist or band, and then comment, like have an hour long commentary on the entire collection of that band or artist's work, like in depth kind of stuff.
Yeah, that's pretty epic. But yeah, so all of this and more to look forward to. If you go to ritualmisery.com, you can see the full schedule. There's going to be a couple of little tweaks to the schedule in the next over the next 24 hours, basically, and then it's going to be final. But this is basically, this is like a 90% final solution that you will see. But we are raising money for children's hospitals through extralife.org, extra-life.org. But like I said, if you go to ritualmisery.com, not only will you see our full schedule, but you'll also have a link to our team page of Extra Life so that you can donate through us. We're trying to raise $1,000. We're like, what, 15% of the way there already?
Yep.
Which is absolutely amazing. I think we are going to destroy the goal of $1,000, and I really hope so, because the children's hospitals that I am familiar with are absolutely the one that Amos, the one that you and I chose to to donate to is Riley Children's Hospital in Indianapolis, Indiana, which is the hospital that my sister went to when we were kids. She had a form of muscular dystrophy, and she had a lot of issues, things that she had to go receive treatment for. And that hospital was absolutely amazing for our family. And this is our opportunity to give back to not just Riley, but so many children's hospitals. It's so great. So even if you don't have time to watch the stream, I encourage everyone to go to ritualmisery.com anyway and click on our link. You can give a dollar. You can give whatever you want, and it will definitely help out the kids.
Yep. Very cool. Yeah, so, I want everybody to go there, even if they're not listening. So last year, I had a chance to join you guys, and I had a lot of fun. This year, I don't have time to do that, but I will absolutely contribute. So I want to make sure that listeners understand they don't have to be listening. They can just go to your website, click on the link, and contribute to this cause because it is a great one.
Yeah. Thank you, Richard.
And most importantly, I mean, overall, everything else, most importantly, I don't have to stream for 24 some odd hours all by myself. So,
but that was so much fun to watch. Come on.
Which was kind of the whole point of getting the whole community involved so that we could be lazier. But you know what? We've put more hours of work into this thing over the last couple of months that way more than 27 hours. So, no, but it's all good. It's such a cool thing. Getting so many people involved, and also the hopes of raising so much money for these kids is going to be absolutely awesome, and I cannot wait. This weekend can't get here quick enough.
So Richard, we don't have a libs for you for this week. We figured this would probably end up going a little long, which of course it has.
I escaped this one. Good.
This is like a double sized issue here.
Yeah, it always is with me. It's a Richard Gunther episode. We didn't offend enough people.
Yeah, I'm sure we did.
Here I am. I have to set the stage for you. All right, I'm walking. I'm taking a weekend away. I'm just spending a weekend away in Florida in Disney World, and I'm walking around Epcot Center, and I have my ear pods in, and I'm listening to whatever happens to be in my queue, and you guys are up, and I'm walking around and looking at all these, you know, kids having a great time and all these families and everything, and hey, here comes Ritual Misery, and we start offending people right out of the gate. Like, we start saying things, and I'm like, oh my God, I can't believe they just said that. And you know what you guys said? And here's, I just love this. This is precious. You're like, oh, this is like a Richard Gunther episode. Seriously? What the fuck? That is
crazy. That's kind of been the history, though. Whenever you come on the show, it's like Amos is in rare form, rarer form than his normal rare form.
Rare form. I have to say, I got a big laugh out of that. I'm sure there were people looking at me like, what is wrong with that guy? Like, what? What
he said. Don't stare, honey. He's got headphones for a reason.
Listen to the archive of our Richard Gunther episodes, because that seems to be the goal to have been...
listeners shouldn't be so sensitive.
Right?
I agree. Get a spine. Deal with it.
All right, Richard. So where can people hear you when you're not being completely trapped by our offensive words and stories?
Ooh, all right. Well, so generally I am heard on Twitter at Richard Gunther. I also have a podcast or two, and you can find them at the Digital Media Zone. I host Home On, home:on. And we talk about home automation technology that you can buy yourself and set up yourself and implement in your home. And there's an episode Damus on it. So you should go check that out because it's pretty fun. And if you're really wondering where you can hear me, like right away, like in the next couple of days, I'm going to be out at CES in Las Vegas, Nevada, and I'm going to be talking about lighting. One of my favorite topics. I'll be talking about connected lighting and how, you know what? It sucks. It's too freaking confusing. It should be easier. Why is it so fucking hard? I won't be allowed to curse on the panel, but I am on a panel at CES talking about connected lighting. So, hey, if you're at CES, come listen. It is called IoT for Everyone. Connected lighting should just work. Duh. Okay, I added the duh.
And of course, if they want to meet you in person, if they can't make it to CES because that is a little bit close, it's really easy to find your way to South by Southwest, and you've been there pretty much every year since forever ago, and chances are pretty good that you'll be there again this year having beers with us. Feel free to stop on by and find him then.
Drinking the free beers we owe him.
I'm gonna stop writing checks or asses can't cash. Can people find you, man?
Yeah, just go to Twitter at @rm_delnoche. There's links to all my stuff there. Anything interesting that I'm doing, you'll see there. But if you're really interested in craft beer like I am, and you're just for whatever reason curious what I thought about a beer, you can go to ratebeer.com, look up username delnoche, and you can read my over half a thousand beer reviews.
Half a thousand. It's called 500.
Couple months I've been saying over 500. I was trying to think of another way to say it, and I screwed it all up. I pulled an Amos on that. no, but
5,000.
Oh man, if I was five, oh my gosh, that's a lot of beer. But no, check me out. Username Delnoche at ratebeer.com, or just go to Twitter. Everything's on Twitter at @rm_Delnoche. Amos, what about you, dude?
At Ethan Kane on Twitter. That's man, I really wish I had more time to do something other than just Twitter. There's so many cool like sources of media out there that I could be
overachieving.
So, look for us on Twitch.
I'm just saying.
Fuck Twitch, by the way.
Be realistic.
Just fuck Twitch. Like, that's not going to happen.
Yeah. Well, we're going to simulcast like 8 services. Anyway, no. Go ahead.
So much fun. Yeah, you can catch me on there, and of course Diamond Club. You see, I'm screwing up the video right now. Like, my feed just crap. Just crap. It's awesome. That was not supposed to be there. And you can just go to richwizard.com.
Picking my nose, like, yeah, Amos, you were not supposed to show me picking my nose.
No, I wish it was that easy.
Oh shit. Mine's not really a thing anymore, is it?
podcastoritualmisery.com. Feel free to stop by there. You can catch us live 7 p.m. on Thursdays at diamondclub.tv. Fuck Twitch, and we will be there for forever. So just gonna make that known, and that's how we're gonna roll this shit. So I got a little music right here I need to play, and while that's playing, I'm just gonna sit there and awkwardly stare at Richard.
We should probably also refer people to incompetech.com if they are interested in the music that's playing right now.
Yeah, go ahead.
Diamond Club hopes you have enjoyed this program.
Oh my god, what a
Diamond
show.
Club hopes you have enjoyed this program.
Yeah, we went a little long on that one.
You think? Oh my god, I wish we had time to do this more often.
We could make like every fourth show a Richard Gunther show.
I have so much fucking fun with you guys. I wish we could do this more. I don't have time for this.
We
don't want to do this more often.
We need to do it like once a month. Just have it once a month and not even have it on like normal, just have it a separate feed for it, just for the Richard rants, and just
oh my god,
go on forever. I'm telling
just
you.
Have it RSS feed, just the Richard Gunther episodes.
Oh my god.
Oh, that'd be great.
That was so funny, though. Seriously, when you were when you guys were like, "Oh my god, this is like a Richard Gunther episode," I'm like, "Wait! Why am I getting dragged into this?"
If I remember right, you tweeted about it.
I did. I totally did.
Oh, jeez.
It's amazing having you on. Every time you're on, I'm just like, oh, thank God Rich is going to be on. I don't have to worry about the episode. It's going to be good. It's going to be good. Guaranteed.
That was so much fun. We like didn't get to go through like a third of our content. Surprise.
Yeah. Surprise. We didn't talk about Pokemon Go or that's really about the only thing we didn't cover.
Or anything going on in my life, you know, because I gave you guys the headline. And did Amos throw it back at me? No, he didn't do that.
It took like 10 minutes just to get through that little block. Like I was
10 minutes just to talk about how awesome we are.
Well, Richard Gunther is awesome. Newsflash for everyone out there. Richard Gunther is awesome.
I'm just giving you shit.
Diamond Club hopes you have enjoyed this program.
This was a long episode. Our apologies. But the good news is if you made it this far, you obviously want more Richard Gunther. You can find more of our time with Richard, an additional 20 plus minutes at patreon.com/ritualmisery. Any pledge level will get you all the exclusive access. It's patreon.com/ritualmisery.